so it's just the concept has changed now.
Okay.
People are more educated. They understand. They're not afraid to travel that far.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a country where it's a secular country. It's one of the biggest democratic society in the world.
Okay.
And I would say that we have all religions in India. Did you know that India is the only country in the world where Jews were accepted?
No.
They were never persecuted. Even till today, they're not persecuted.
Wow.
But we have very few Jews left. When they ran away from Iran because of the persecution, they came to India and they came to Kochi. And they docked in Kochi, and the king of Cochin refused to let them get off the boat. And he said, no, I don't want you coming here and converting the people into Judaism. And they said, but that's not our religion. You have to be born through a Jewish mother to be Jewish. So after quite a bit of negotiation, the king said, okay, I allow you to come, but you cannot convert anybody. And they said, fine. They lived there for many, many years till the Jewish state was established. And that's when the Jews started leaving.
Hmm.
But they will never, till today, they'll tell you, we were never persecuted in India.
Wow.
We were accepted for who we are. We were. And there's a very beautiful story that I read in a magazine recently where an older Jewish woman, she's about in her 90s, and a Muslim man takes care of her.
Hmm.
And it just goes to show you that religion in India is not such a big deal.
Mm.
As long as you're not hurting anybody, you're not forcing anyone to convert, you're accepted for who you are and what you do in life.
That sounds great.
Yes. It's just amazing. And you know, another interesting point now that I'm talking to you that's come to my mind is wherever you travel to India, you'll find the skin tone changes.
Okay.
Like you go to the Punjab area, Delhi, and you go to Amritsar, you'll sometimes find somebody who's blonde-haired and blue-eyed.
Really?
Yes, because they're from Aryan, they're Aryan descent.
Okay.
And you'll find that they have high cheekbones, sharp features, whereas where I come from, you go down south, we're very, very dark.
Okay.
You go to Kashmir, which is up north, close to the Himalayas, they're absolutely white.
Huh.
Yes. Very where light
would
skin.
Where would I blend in the most?
My state.
Okay.
You're definitely from my state.
Okay. What's going to be my Indian name? I need a good one.
You need a good one.
Yeah. What's a traditional?
Oh, there's so many names.
Okay.
There's so many names. There are a lot of beautiful names. You know, there is, what would I name you?
Yeah, what would you name
me? I think I would name you Saraswati. Because
there's a book. Isn't there a book?
She's a goddess of learning.
Oh.
And the reason why I want to give you that name is because you're very learned.
Okay.
And what I love about you is that when you impart your knowledge, you do it very humbly.
Oh, thank you.
With a lot of generosity, without any expectation.
Thank you.
That's who you are.
Okay.
That's your Indian
name.
Now
I need to learn how to pronounce it. Say it again.
Sara. Swati.
Swati.
So it's S A
okay
R A S
okay
W A T I
okay I'll take that name. Perfect.
And what I wanted to also share with you, if you go down south and you go to Rajasthan, they're very proud people. They'll never beg. You won't find a beggar there. People don't beg there. It's very beneath them. They'd rather die hungry.
Wow.
But they will never beg for money or food. In Rajasthan, what I also want to tell you about the women of Rajasthan, which is really nice, if you go to a place called Jodhpur, there's a fort called Mehrangarh Fort. It was a fortress palace. And you go and you look at the walls and you'll find imprint of female hands. And the story is, in the old days, when the husbands would go to war, the king and the warriors, the wives would be left behind. And the queens, if they found out that their husbands were killed, they would dip their hands in red, paint,
okay,
just to make it easy for you to understand, and put imprints of their hands on the wall. They would light a bonfire,
okay,
sticks laid out flat, and they would make themselves sit on the stick, and they would burn themselves alive.
Wow.
That's what they did. And the reason behind that is they didn't want to be taken as sex slaves or have to convert into a different religion.
Hmm.
This is how proud Rajputs are.
Wow.
They would never, even till today, they're very proud people.
Wow.
Yeah. So you, there's a story, every state you go to, there's a different story to be told. You go to Goa and you'll find a very heavy Portuguese influence over there. You see the old homes and you'll find the old tiles, Portuguese files, tiles over there. The food, heavy Portuguese influence over there. The bread pudding that they have there is just fascinating. Mm. Yeah. And and that's what I, you know, my mother had a very interesting story to tell. She was English. So when she came to India, she was very poor. My father didn't have much money. They were young. They was just starting out in life. And she said there was these Christian ladies that would go home to home to convert people to Christianity. And my mother never experienced anything like this before. So her neighbor, who she was very good friends with, was a Hindu. So the Christians came and they were talking about Jesus and how fantastic Jesus was and he was going to save her life. And she sat, stood there for 1 hour, took it all in, very gracious, gave her the Bible, gave her the cross. And after they left, she says, now Jesus is a Hindu. She goes to her temple and she puts the cross in her temple. And she said, he's a Hindu now. It's okay, I can pray to him.
That's
so you get to see how they adapt things.
Mm.
We know how to adapt things. We know how to, you know, if something out of the ordinary happens, we know how to, you know, bring it in and say, okay, this is ours.
Mm.
Let's see what we can do.
Mm.
I can take you to India right now, and I can take you in the middle of the night to someone's home, and they will have food sitting on the table. They will not say it's late, come back another day, or you didn't call me and tell me you were coming. You'll never hear that from an Indian.
Mm.
You'll never hear that. If an Indian ever says that to you, I would be very shocked, because that is not India. It's not at all being Indian. That's not hospitality.
Wow.
There's a very interesting story. When Mark took his group to India, they were in the desert. And they were cooking the food and there was a sandstorm. So the food got destroyed, basically. It got spoiled. And the milk that they had to be thrown out. So they went to a poor person's home. And this lady was heating up some milk for her two children. And the guy said, you know, we need milk because we have these foreigners here and we have to give them coffee because they're used to coffee and tea in the mornings.
Mm.
The milk that she was supposed to give to her children, she gave to him.
Wow.
And she says, no, they're our guests. You have to take care of our guests. So Mark said, what about your children? She said, you don't worry about them. She said, they have to know that our guests come first.
Wow.
She didn't even take money, nothing. But it shows you that even the poorest person will find some kind of joy in giving back to somebody who has much more than themselves.
Mm.
This is what it's all about. And I think we learn a lot from people if we open ourselves up and not close our minds to anything. You know, talking about women, Shah Jahan, his wife, he was very much in love with his wife. And she sometimes even accompanied him to war. And that's why he loved her the most out of all his wives.
Mm.
And after she died, he was very heartbroken. And he made her a promise that he would build a palace for her. So he built the Taj Mahal for her, a mausoleum. So you see how powerful these women were, even in those days. They were the backbone as far as their men were concerned.
Mm.
So I say, don't underestimate a woman.
Exactly.
<Right? laughs> There are many, many stories to tell. You go to, it's just the palaces that amaze me. And no two palaces are alike.
Mm.
They're so different. And you go down south and you see the palaces. You will be seeing a few palaces down south and you'll say, doesn't feel like a palace, doesn't look like a palace because they're not ostentatious.
Okay.
South Indians are very humble. They are very simple, down-to-earth people.
Okay.
They're the earth of the people. And yet when you go to Northern India and you see the palaces, it's so splendid. They're magnificent. Mm-hmm. And the murals, that are painted in the palace, and the inlay stones that are semi-precious stones, and some are precious stones, are just, you sit there and you go, I'm so lucky to see all of this.
Wow.
And that's why when people tell me, you know what, I can't go to India, it's too far away, or the poverty and the dust, it gets to me. I feel, you know, you're shortchanging yourself.
Mm.
You shouldn't do that. Really shouldn't. So I can see you buying a lot of jewelry there.
That's my weakness.
That's your weakness.
Yes.
No.
Clothes and jewelry.
Jewelry. Down south is a lot of gold.
Okay.
They believe in gold. You go to Rajasthan, it's more silver.
Okay.
Diamonds, because they were also diamond merchants.
Okay.
Over there. And you go to Ladakh, they're into turquoise.
Okay.
Heavy turquoise jewelry. You come to my state, where I'm from, we're into gold.
Okay.
And we're into semi-precious stones also.
Okay.
So those are the difference when you go to different parts of India.
Okay.
It's very interesting. Everything is so different. It's so vibrant. You know, the desert, you go to a desert region, you say, oh my God, there's not a tree over there. And then you look at the people, you go, my God, they make it up. There's no color there.
Hmm.
They, you know, the colors are so vibrant. They wear the reds and the blues and the yellows. Everybody's a different color as far as their outfits are concerned. And it's beautiful. Another beautiful, beautiful thing about India is that there's always a festival to celebrate.
My kind of people.
Your kind of people. We have clients who, we had a couple of clients who specially traveled to India. Have you ever heard of Holi?
Is that the color festival?
Yes, yeah. The watercolor festival.
Yeah.
We had some clients who specially went to India just to participate in that.
Wow.
So we had families, our personal families, invite them
okay.
for the color festival. We even had the royal family who invited one of our clients, found out that they were there and said, no, you have to bring them. They need to play with us.
Oh, wow.
And so they saw the whole ritual of the festivals and the prayers. They participated in the prayers that we have in the mornings
mm-hmm.
and the food that we share with everybody.
Mm-hmm.
So it doesn't matter whether you're rich or poor, we all play together. So there's a festival. And also Diwali, have you heard about fireworks?
No.
It's like your 4th of July over here.
Okay.
But it's in a much grander scale. And it's basically the fight between good over evil. And good wins.
Okay.
So it's the whole story about that. And the fireworks we do is because we are conquering evil. We won. And you'll find that all the homes in the old days, they were lit with oil lamps. And the reason why we lit them today, of course, we use electric lights and everything. But we do that because we invite the goddess of wealth, Lakshmi, to come to our house. So
I'll invite her in too.
You should. You should. She's coming to visit you.
Perfect. I've been waiting for her.
So it's interesting. And then when I want to talk about Hinduism, is people say, oh, you have too many gods. And I say, no, we have just one God. You have to understand that the poor person in the old days, he was uneducated or she was uneducated. So she didn't understand the aspect of God. So what man did was, they created different facets of God. Mm. So they said, here's one representation of God, goddess of wealth. Mm. Here's another representation of God, God of, fighting over good over evil. Here's another God who does prosperity. Mm. So then really it's just one God.
Mm.
That's what it's all about. Mm. We have one God. But it's interesting how we practice. It depends which part of India you go to. We pray to different deities. And at the end of the day, it's the same thing.
Hmm.
It's the same way of prayers that we do. That's what we do in India.
Perfect.
And it's funny. Today I wore my sari and the other day somebody saw me with my bindi. We call it a bindi.
Okay.
Today is just a decoration.
Okay.
And in the old days, what it was, when we went to pray, mm-hmm. even now when we go to the temple, we get a little red powder or a white powder and we put it in the middle of our foreheads to say that we did our prayers. And the reason why we did that is to remind us that God has three eyes.
Mm.
During the daytime, with his two eyes, he watches us. At night when he's sleeping, his third eye is watching over us. So you never really escape.
Huh. I never heard that before.
Yes.
Okay.
That's what it is. That was the that is the tradition of wearing a bindi.
Okay.
It is the third eye. But today it's like wearing lipstick.
Got it.
Yes.
Okay.
That's how we do it.
That's so neat. I love that.
There are a lot of stories to tell. And it's going to be, it's always, every time I go to India, it's a soul searching experience. And I find I become a better person than I was when I first went there. And I hope this time around, I'll be an even better person when I come back. I really do. And there is one place you're going to be visiting. It's called Chetinad.
Okay.
What I love about Chetinad, it's a tiny little village. The homes are mansions. You've not seen homes like this in America.
Hmm.
The homes are about a block long. So they have two entrances.
Wow.
One is one entrance, let's say the north entrance, and then there's another entrance, the south entrance. So if you're coming from another side, you can enter from that way. And you'll be staying at one of those homes. And you will find in all these homes, the kitchen is always outside the house, never in the house. So when there's cooking is being done, the smell of the food doesn't come into the house. That's how they cooked in the old days.
Mm.
It was never inside the house. You're going to be meeting with a wonderful lady who has a property over there. And she's converted her personal home into a hotel. And she will tell you why she did it.
Okay.
You know, and the reason behind it all. She is a very wonderful human being. I have never met her, so I'll be meeting her for the first time with you. But the CGH Earth, who owns Visalam, that's where we're going to be staying. This is a home that was built for a daughter who was getting married. And although in this area, what you'll find that there's a courtyard, and people didn't sleep in the bedroom. So everybody slept outside, the men on one side, women on one side. And but when this woman got married, they decided to come to a bigger city because there's really not much happening there. So what they did is that they went to CGH Earth, signed a lease with them and said, okay, run it as a hotel. So that is a home that was never lived in. Mm-hmm. And the utensils which you'll be using for eating,
mm-hmm.
the plates, the vessels that are used for cooking, those were all given as a dowry gift to the daughter at the time of her marriage, which was never used. So what I love about the properties over there is that they all speak. They all talk. They have a story to tell.
Mm-hmm.
People don't realize that when you travel, it has to tell you a story. There has to be something behind it. You can't just go because so-and-so said so, or you read something somewhere.
Mm-hmm.
It has to speak to your soul, and your soul needs to say, you know what? I had a hunger, and it somewhat satisfied me. Now I need to go somewhere else to mm-hmm. satisfy that hunger. And you grow with that experience, whether it be a good one or a bad one. There's something you learn from it all. You do.
I can't wait. I'm so excited about the trip.
There are so much to tell you. Gujarat is another beautiful destination. I love it. You'll find the different tribes. When you go to different areas of Gujarat, you'll find that there are palaces, but different kinds of palaces. They're not ostentatious. And the ruling family, they've converted into hotels. And if you see the furniture and the chandeliers, it's chandeliers bought from Belgium. Mirrors are from Belgium. And the antiques are just phenomenal, really phenomenal. But my best experience in Gujarat was when we went to see the wild asses. So they are a crossbreed between horses and donkeys.
Okay.
So they're short in stature.
Okay.
They look like donkeys and they also look like horses, but they run very fast.
Their
speed is such where they're in spurts. So they run very fast, they get tired and they stop.
Mm.
So what my guy did, he did something very interesting. He says, you want to see if you can catch up to them? I say, yeah. And the Jeep went so fast, they outran us.
Wow.
That's how fast they are. But they're very shy. They don't come up to you. They won't.
Okay.
And I wish we were going there, but it's...
Next trip.
Next trip, yes. Next trip. And you'll find that there are five continents in the world. India is one of the five continents in the world.
Wow.
Yeah. And we have lots of seaports, and that's why we had a lot of trading with different countries, with the Dutch, with the Portuguese, with the Greeks. The Greeks came, like I said, Alexander the Great came. We had, of course, the English, the French. You will be you'll go to Pondicherry and you'll find you're in France. They all speak French there. I remember I had a friend who went to school with me, and she, because she was born in Pondicherry, she automatically had French citizenship.
Oh,
and
wow.
She spoke French, yeah. But it was very many years ago, the Indian government put a stop to that. They said, no, you're part of India. You have to speak the Indian language, and you cannot get French citizenship anymore. That rule was abolished. But you go there, you'll find that there are two towns. One is known as the Black Town, where the Tamils live, mm-hmm. and one is known as the White Town, and that's where the French-speaking Tamilians live. Mm. And you really will feel you're in France.
Oui, oui.
Oui, oui.
Oui, oui.
And what is beautiful there also, they have a place called Auroville. And it's a French lady who built up this sanctuary. And you can go there and meet with the people. You can do meditation there. They talk about their the way they meditate, the history of the place. And they also have a place where if you go to Pondicherry and you don't have a place to stay, they have a women's section and a women's section where you can live, you can eat, and you, in return, I believe you have to work there.
Okay.
And that too in itself, if you are looking for something of that caliber, then yes, you can do that.
Hmm.
It's really wonderful. And we have a lot of beaches in India. So you take your pick which beach you want.
Perfect.
Yeah. And we have a lot of villas.
Okay.
Homes that were converted, that are now converted into villas. So you not only get to live in the country, but you get a feel of the country when you enter into these properties. That's how it feels. It's just magnificent.
I can't wait.
And you're going to have to eat with your hands.
Okay.
And there is a scientific way. Where I come from, mm-hmm. you don't dirty this part of the hand.
Okay.
Because if you do, then they say, you don't have class.
Okay.
You don't know how to eat. So it's just the fingertips that you use to eat with your hands. And it's an art form. You go to South India and they eat differently. So it's funny how we all eat. It's very different.
Hmm.
And it's so diverse. It is, I have not seen, I've traveled to many countries, but India, I try to do a little bit at a time because it's too much to absorb, even as an Indian, having been an Indian myself, now I live in America, it's too much to take in at one time.
Hmm.
There's a lot to absorb. So I usually do short trips when I go back. And I try to bring back a little bit of myself, of that country, wherever I travel with me. And I try to leave a little bit of myself in that country.
I'll do the same.
You do the same.
I'll do the same.
Veronica, I'm looking forward to traveling with you. I'm very excited. You better get your bags packed. I don't want to hear you left something behind. But we do have Marks and Spencers in India. So if you leave your underwear behind.
Perfect.
We'll go shopping.
I'm just wearing saris the whole time.
You're wearing saris? Okay.
Yes.
And I want to thank you very much for joining me. It's been a pleasure having you here. Thank you for joining us at Travel Tales with Debica. We look forward to seeing you next time.